through these suits, by issuing injunctions. We have criminal remedies as well. A complaint could be filed. And necessarily, that process and then ultimately finding the guilty in the bringing to the court and then to the jail. But then necessarily only one has to go because one has to be stayed during the process of the other. So therefore, I believe that Indian courts are trying their level best to enforce. We have the laws updated, so protection is provided for. We have the enforcement agency coming up, gearing up. So I believe we have a better future, and we hope for the best. Now I would invite if any question is there for any of the panelists, you may please announce your name and then also please also speak out as to in whose direction, which panelist is to answer your question.
Sir.
Me?
By law, we all have a vague idea what is IPR, types of IPR and all. But the major issue what comes to my mind is like how do we stop the misuse of the IPR regime? Like, for example, I'll give you one seed company's example. Like, the people who get, we all know that for our innovation, we get some incentive for a limited period of time. Like, we can use it for our own benefit. So the seed companies who...
Now, please don't bring in any individual case.
No individual case.
You can ask generally about a particular aspect, but not general particular case.
Okay, we'll talk about the general technologies which are coming to India.
Yes.
Suppose they come and they start, first they start giving on the royalty basis their technologies, and they come and ask our farmers or people that you don't invest on R&Ds because we are supplying you the technology. So these people, they stop their R&D and they stop taking, they start taking their technologies. Once, you know, they start taking the technologies and their R&Ds are over, these guys, they start acting pricey in a way. Like in a layman's language, I'm saying that they start acting pricey. They say, you take my technologies, but you cannot share it, you cannot do this. There are so many constraints, like you cannot sell it, you cannot do. How do we stop that? Because then our technologies are, like our R&D is over, and now these guys who have got, you know, exclusive right over those patents, they are misusing that in a way. How do we stop that? Is there any law for that?
Well, you see, as I said, the law is being updated. Now in 2007 also, there is a bill pending so far Patent Act is concerned. And with that, I believe there will be definitely improvements so far protection and enforcement of patent are also concerned. And if you have any such particular instance, you can bring it to the notice of the legislatures and the law ministry and the concerned ministry. I believe agriculture ministry, this will be taken notice of.
Are we gearing up for the WTO with all these agreements done to counter those, like to make our judiciary system that strong, since so many...
See, so far judiciary is concerned, judiciary cannot go out of the legislations that it is available. Although in some of the matters they are entertaining petitions and suits. But it has its own limitations. Yes, any other question?
Sir, one question.
Yes.
My question to additional Solicitor General. You quite nicely distinguish dominating patent and improvement patent. So I see, I have heard that the way improvement patent is coming up, the area of improvement patent more go large. In that situation, it will be very difficult to control.
I think you're right. That's if I may say, a teasing issue of patent jurisprudence. That is, as I said, where you draw the line, where you have a dominating patent and you come up with an improvement patent. Does it fall, as I said, foul of the principle and become double patent? Now, that will have to be case by case, depending on the facts of a particular case. But the principle in law is clear. You are right, its application is an area which is not far from here. So it will depend on the facts of the case.
Sir, I was more interested in what about the Laos case in Delhi High Court? What was the actual forum? Because the REIT or it was a suit?
It was a suit. I had decided that matter, so I know for a fact.
Specific
yes.
But what happened, the defendants are mostly government professionals residing in Delhi, residing in Mumbai. So
see, this Yahoo was based in, not in India at that point of time. But they had, you see, Yahoo had entered into an arrangement with different countries in different parts. But they had not come to India and did not open an office here or entered into any collaboration agreement with anybody saying that there should be Yahoo India. They had by that time Yahoo Singapore, for example.
There is a question of jurisdiction.
Just a minute. I'm coming to that. Yahoo Singapore they had. They had Yahoo International, which is their basic. But they did not have any office here, Yahoo India. A gentleman, a violator, he started a domain name in the name of Yahoo India so as to get all the business from Yahoo in the name of Yahoo. So there, see, Yahoo International came to the court. Although they were not physically present, as I said. They were not physically present. They came and filed a suit seeking for injunction that we are the actual Yahoo and our name cannot be misused or can be used by this gentleman. So there, you see, we had imported not only this trans-border reputation but also the trademark, because it is a trademark which is being used and violated. So therefore, there being an infringement of that, we issued an injunction. And once the injunction is issued, the other gentleman, he came to the court and said that I'm not using anymore, so you may please decide this matter. And we decided and finished off.
In this case, defendant resides in Delhi.
Yes.
That's why it's jurisdiction.
Yes. Yes.
Mostly dominants are provided by providers are residing in Mumbai. And they are creating problems at the time of renewal.
No, see, there again, Mumbai court will have jurisdiction. Mumbai is also having number of cases.
Mumbai,
yes, that will have to be decided looking at the facts. But if any, you see, so far jurisdiction is concerned, there are cases of the Supreme Court now. You see, earlier there was one decision that has now been upset by the Supreme Court, and they have provided under the Copyright Act, for example, what is 62, Section 63. Of the Copyright Act. So under that, the jurisdiction will be guided. So those aspects will have to be looked into. We are not going into any individual case here. Yes, any other question?
All right, I was taking Mr. Jacob's point for enforcement aspect. There was, in fact, that is in Delhi High Court in intellectual property matter. There is a feeling that even though plaintiff is able to prove his case beyond reasonable doubt and defendant also admits of committing infringement, at the end of the day, in civil side, damages are not awarded, which can be major deterrent for the defendant. And at the criminal side, the major constable force, so to say, is not intellectual property trained to commit grassroots enforcement. So, though ex parte injunctions are granted and those trials also take place, but the whole process of proving a case, evidence, bringing foreign witnesses to India and doing that also, when we don't get damages, then the defendants are not deterred. They will just relocate and start activity again, and plaintiff has to spend more money in chasing them, committing another case. So we are not getting action in contempt, we are not getting action as monetary damages, even though it may go to charity, not to plaintiff. And similarly for grassroots and criminal aspect.
Yes, now so far this question is concerned, instead of Jacob, I may reply to this question as well. Now, so far damages are concerned. Now you say damages are not being given, but that's not the correct position. I have been there associated with Delhi High Court for a very pretty long time. And we have been granting injunction, but may not be commensurate with the loss suffered. But in one case I know, Times Incorporated versus Lokesh Srivastava. This is an MNC company. A million rupees was given. So that to that extent we had gone. About 10 lakhs of rupees we had given as a compensation.
Justice Gogol has granted 19 lakhs also.
So therefore, it's may not, but it's...
But you know, that's really not as general.
Well, may not be so, but you see, once one has to dole out 19 lakhs of rupees, you think it is a small amount of money? In Indian context, you think about the Indian context, number one. Number two, so far criminal cases are concerned, the criminal courts are now taking interest in these matters. So far law enforcing agency is concerned, as you rightly say, they are not trained because we do not have a separate investigating authority so far IPR matters are concerned. But they are at the moment have created a separate cell so far cyber laws are concerned. They have a separate cell Delhi police at least has a separate cell for cyber crimes are concerned. So therefore, I believe things will improve. And you see, this is sort of a trial and error method. When we face with a problem, we wake up. So that's what is happening.
My question is on transborder reputation and well-known marks. Now the problem is the whole basis of trademark and this well-known mark protection is on this confusion theory and dilution theory, wherein well-known trademarks, even though they might not cause confusion, are still protected. But there are a number of judgments in the High Court, more specifically in Delhi, wherein they've considered this whole concept and said that it is well-known, but then it might not cause confusion, and therefore we will not protect it. Now, this attitude of the court, is it right? Why? Because the whole point in protecting well-known marks is this dilution theory. Even though they might not confusion, we still protect it. Now, this aspect has to be considered.
I understood your question.
Yes.
Now, if there is a confusion, that is according to you, but the court, according to the court, there is no confusion. Necessarily, one has to decide, and you have to accept the decision of the court. If you are aggrieved, you have a higher court. So therefore, ultimately, it is the perception of the judge who looks into both the sides, and thereafter comes to a conclusion that there is no confusion. If you are aggrieved, you have a higher court to go to, and the higher court gives a decision that is final and binding. So there is no confusion there. So that's as simple as that.
If I may ask.
All right, now it's all right. Yes. Yes.
Question from Mr. Tripathi.
Yes.
You are talking about patents and pharma. India is a developing nation. The major concern is protecting its traditional knowledge of medicine, the domestic medicine. We recently saw how this US has granted patent for turmeric as bone healing, and then after the objection of CSIR, they had to, you know, cut off that patent. So are we doing something in that regard, like domestic traditional knowledge and, you know, putting it all together and doing something for that?
That's a good idea, but it would require concentrated effort, not only from the government, but from various NGOs and other organizations. The problem is that in the patent regime, whether it is traditional patent or other patent, patenting has to follow a particular procedure. Also, the problem in traditional patenting would be, it is one thing to, you know, block somebody else's patent. But the other problem is, can it not be said that it is today obvious? Today it is obvious. It is
okay.
In the public domain. So
yes.
These are issues there, but you are right. One should have a setup where these are examined, and wherever it is possible, traditional medicines, etc., get patented. But remember this, that if it is obvious and it is in the public domain, then its ability to get patented to that extent is diluted.
Mr. Tripathi, I have a question in relating to pharma patenting. Actually, this question primarily revolves around two cases, the Oncomouse case and the Relaxin case. After these two cases, there was a huge UN cry with relation to the pain being caused to the animals. That was in the prior case of Oncomouse. The mouse was genetically modified in this case. And the second case is the Relaxin case, in which the pregnant females, they release certain hormones which eases the pain in their body. And the doctors, they wanted to extract that particular hormone and create medicines for pain reliever particular. So after these two cases, there was a lot of human cry with relation to the pain and the agony being caused to the animals and human beings. So how far is it justifiable?
No, what you asked is a very important issue, but perhaps not within the framework of the patent law.
Because the researchers, they wanted a patent on these particular medicines.
What you're saying is that in order to develop a new medicine or a new pharma product, if your route to development involves pain and suffering to either animals or to human beings, how far is it correct or justiciable? That's a moral issue. The other issue is how far is it legitimate? Now, that is a separate issue. I guess rightly so, there's a mix of both. An answer again would depend on the famous mantra in law, case by case. Fact by fact. So they would, I agree with you. If it's a case of blatant violation, particularly in case of human beings, non-consensual, the question has to be answered negatively, that you can't do it. But if it is consensual, if there is greater public good at the other end, public interest is involved, if you are